Crack open a tepid Genesee, watch the pictures as they travel through your neighbor's Wi-Fi. It's the Rees Company. I'm Steve Rees, the bull of American broadcasting, alongside the great Chris Morganti. Very excited tonight. We have a very special movie of the week coming up in just a bit. This one is called Law and Order from 1976, and we'll get to that shortly. But first, Chris, when you pulled up tonight, I was outside. I saw you pull up, and your car looked a lot different than it did the last time I saw you and it.
Yeah. You know, you figure your car would be safe from avian catastrophes in the month of January, but apparently that is not the case. Apparently there's some tree near where I park my car. I believe it's a locust. I believe it's in the locust family. That they have like these pea pod shaped fruit that come off of them. That apparently by January they have fermented, and the birds had quite a party in the tree under which I was parked. And it looks like my car was assaulted. It looks like World War II bombardier footage of the city of Dresden. It's horrible, and it's a black car, and it's green poop. So you can imagine.
So you're saying this is poop, not residue from the berries?
Yes, this is actual. Yes, they pooped out the drunken birds.
Drunken birds
pooped on my car in an unimaginable scene. It's unimaginable.
It had to go somewhere. Now, do you see these birds?
That's a weird thing. I didn't not know there was any birds around. The only place I've seen them is by the chimney of the nearby building. You know, I figure they're trying to keep warm. But man, they had quite a party this week.
Well,
quite a party.
They enjoyed themselves.
Yeah.
And that's something you can always just wash off.
Sure.
Wash off, yeah. Last week's show, we started off with a pretty interesting scenario that you presented. A hypothetical one. A battle among mounted armies of four factions. We had rhinos, unicorns, pegasi, and centaurs.
Well, now I got to stop you, Steve. There were a battle among cavalry armies. We did both a mounted and unmounted scenario. So.
But mounted was the one. I think that was where the argument rested.
Yeah. Yeah, because, I mean, it really didn't make much sense for them not to be mounted.
What makes even less sense is all this violence was somehow instigated by Martina McBride.
Right.
Still don't know what the root of that is.
Yeah, no idea.
Now, we did ask for viewer input on whether we were wrong and if folks agree on the victor. I believe the Pegasus or the team of Pegasi were the ones we determined to be superior.
Yeah.
Fighting force.
In a narrow victory over the Centaurs. But we thought both those factions would destroy the unicorns and the rhinoceroses.
Now, the A-bomb came up with a way for the centaur to be victorious.
Okay.
Definitively.
All right.
Basically, if you have a man mounting the centaur, and one of the things we brought up was how difficult it would be when you have basically a human as part of the animal, has two limbs, upper limbs. And so would the human. So they'd kind of neutralize one another.
Yeah, they're getting in each other's way is what's going to happen.
Well, here's what the A-bomb came up with. If you have the man who's mounting the centaur, but he's facing the other way, they can both be doing their own things. For example, the human part of the centaur can take on the rhinos, for instance. And the man on the back facing the centaur's hindquarters, he can take aim at, say, the Pegasus in the air.
Well, sure.
With two free hands, and the man part of the centaur would also have two free hands. That would present an advantage.
I guess, but only if you're simultaneously facing a frontal assault and an aerial assault, right? Otherwise,
there also could be an assault from behind.
Well, that means you're surrounded. It seems like you're already losing the battle at that point. So I appreciate her input in this, but I'm not sure I entirely agree. But I think you'd need some sort of like saddle that swivels, kind of like our chairs do, you know? Maybe if you had something like that, that would be to the centaur's advantage.
Well, that's just ridiculous.
Yeah.
Kind of, I have an interesting addendum to our recent programming. The two films we talked about most recently in the movie of the week segment, they featured the same actress.
Helen Hunt.
Yeah, a young Helen Hunt. First, in the title role of quarterback princess, and then with a similar part, a smaller part in Angel Dusted. So I had Helen Hunt on my mind last week when I looked into something, Chris, because I couldn't help but wonder if the phrase Helen Hunt had made its way into Cockney rhyming slang. And it turns out I was right.
Oh, boy.
Please don't put this on the screen. You can imagine what I'm talking about. But I also learned this. Helen Hunt, in some circles, is not only a derogatory noun, but also a verb. And it's defined by Urban Dictionary as to throw yourself out a window as if you were on crank. You know what that refers to, Chris?
I do not.
Well, Urban Dictionary kind of mishandles this part of it. The derivation is a reference to one of Hunt's early roles, an 80s after-school special entitled Angel Dusted. Now, the film we commented on was a primetime made-for-TV motion picture. It was not an afternoon ABC after-school special.
Right.
This claims, in Angel Dusted, she throws herself out a window after trying angel dust at the behest of her creepy, crank-making boyfriend. And here's an example, used in a sentence.
Okay.
I need to leave the office before I Helen Hunt myself out of this bitch.
All right. Now, that's fantastic. I love the usage of that. However, that did not happen in that movie.
It did not. But it turns out it did happen in an ABC After School special. I think it was originally titled Just Say No.
Okay.
But the funny YouTube creators have renamed this clip Mad About Crank.
Okay.
Let's see this, Jim.
Oh, good thing there's no trophies around.
The quality of this video is very bad, but she jumps out of the window and starts cutting herself with the shards of glass that fell below. And she felt like Tim Stewart, so she's perfectly fit.
Yeah.
Or she's no son.
Well, when you're all hopped up, though, you kind of tend to do that.
But you can break limbs.
Yeah. Unless you break them, though, you're pretty much good to go. Is there more to this?
Yeah, I think we're okay.
So
that's the clip in question.
So is this going to be the movie we watch next week? Because why wouldn't we?
It can be. I'm concerned about the quality of the film not being worth...
Yeah, it's not so good.
Yeah.
But oddly enough, the movie we're going to talk about this week also involves someone flying through a window in much the same fashion.
Well, we did talk about it earlier. This is probably going to be a shorter episode than the folks are used to, right?
Yeah, but before we get to that, do we need to? We're at two episodes from Meredith Baxter Burney, and now we're finding about a third that involves Helen Hunt. Is our whole premise off? In how we rate these movies. Should they be rated by Helen Hunt's rather than Meredith Baxter's?
I don't know, because I think Meredith Baxter is more connected with this genre of film. Helen Hunt went on to have a fantastic television and film career. She's an Oscar winner.
Yeah.
Most people do not think of Helen Hunt as being part of this scene, if you want to call it.
Yeah, I think there's a large untapped market of made-for-TV Meredith Baxter Burney movies that we have yet to get to.
Well,
I believe you're right about that.
My concern is a lot of those were made probably in the 90s for Lifetime. That's when she really became the queen of that genre.
Right. But it certainly wasn't her genesis, as we'll see tonight.
Are you sure? Are you sure about that, Chris?
I am 100% positive on that.
I beg to differ, but we'll get to that. So shall we just do this? First, I want to say very excited because we have an excellent addition to the program.
Uh-oh.
Well, Chris, you're aware of this.
No, I'm not.
You saw this.
Nope.
Okay. Well, we do have tonight's... tonight. You could easily call tonight's movie of the week an epic.
Yes.
And it's a perfect night, a fitting night, to introduce our new intro.
You know what? I got to say, and I'm sorry to interrupt you, Steve.
Oh, no, you're fine, Chris.
But wouldn't it be nice if we had like a... like a theme song that we could play with this stuff?
That would be fantastic.
Yeah, we should work on that. I'm just saying, I don't mean to be a dick.
Oh, what is this? What do we have here?
Exactly what I was thinking.
Oh,
can we just say congrats to Jim Corhan on a job well done right there? Oh, shit.
For putting.
Am I not supposed to say your last name, Jim? You're going to have to bleep that out, I guess.
Everything's fine. Jim's giving us the, go.
He
on,
likes
then.
To go by just Jim.
So, as mentioned earlier, the movie of the week this week is entitled Law & Order, and it debuted on network television in 1976. Shall I provide some background, Chris?
Please.
Okay. It's based on the novel by the same name by a woman called Dorothy Unack. She was a real-life NYPD detective turned crime novelist.
How about that?
Many of her works were adapted for the small screen, and some became series. I have two examples, Police Woman with Angie Dickinson.
Never heard of it.
And Kojak with Telly Savalas.
Oh, yeah.
Others became made-for-TV motion pictures. Strangely, none of them were released to cinemas.
Right.
And all of her books were adapted entirely for projects for television, either series or made-for-TV movies. She wrote Law & Order, the novel, to mirror Mario Puzo's The Godfather.
Yeah. And I was going to say it bears a lot of similarities to that.
It's a it's an epic. It spans generations, three generations in this case. And instead of focusing on a family of mobsters, it focuses on a family involved in law enforcement.
And, but, you know, I'll say, Steve, another film it reminded me of is Scorsese's Gangs of New York.
I haven't seen that one.
I love that movie, and it's kind of similar to that in many respects.
Are you suggesting that there might be an influence of this film far beyond the world of made-for-TV motion pictures?
No. I wouldn't go that far. Okay. Yeah. That's stretching it, I think.
Well, Dorothy Unack, the author, she died in 2006 at the age of 76 by a bizarre cause for a woman her age.
Did she dive out a plate glass window?
No, but she may as well have. It was actually the part before that. It was a self-administered drug overdose.
Self-administered?
Yeah.
Well, wait, okay. Well, most of them would be self-administered, right? But
it was an intentional drug overdose.
Yeah,
is how I read
it. Yeah.
Now, I have no information as to why, but I'm guessing it probably had something to do with the seductive wiles of Kim Delaney.
<I don't know. laughs>
Now, this TV production, Law & Order, without commercials, it ran for more than 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
Which is no surprise. The director was Marvin J. Chomsky. You know what else he directed?
No.
Roots.
Oh, okay.
So he was familiar with wasting a lot of film.
You're going to say that on MLK weekend?
Well, no, I don't mean that the projects were wasteful. I mean that you can make a two-hour movie and you will save more film than you do if you make a three-hour movie or a six-hour movie.
By the way, have we pointed out yet that this has absolutely no relation to the TV series Law & Order,
which wouldn't appear
for another 14 years?
Right. Now, in the comments section, because we find and view these movies on YouTube, and if you read the comments section, a lot of people are under the impression that this was the first episode of Law & Order.
Yeah. There's a lot of stupid people that comment on YouTube.
Very confused. I love this show. Can't believe it was on in the 70s.
Yeah, where's Sam Waterston?
And it bears no resemblance to Law & Order.
No.
Because in the TV show, you see the cops, the detectives investigate. And then the justice system, it moves forward into the courts.
Yeah, they did 20 seasons of a complete formula, every single episode the same formula. So why anyone would think anything that didn't fit that exact formula would be related?
I don't see a single attorney or DA. And I guess there's a grand jury at one point, but at the very end. There are a lot of recognizable names, Chris.
Well, recognizable to some. But I only recognize like two, but okay.
And who are they?
Well, the protagonist, I believe his first name is Darren
McGavin.
McGavin, yeah. who I knew from as being a movie I was forced to watch more than I ever wanted to, A Christmas Story. He was the father in A Christmas Story.
Yes. Now, why were you forced to watch that movie?
He was the guy who bought the leg lamp, right? He was the guy who would go down and fight the furnace. So, you all, unfortunately, you've probably all seen that movie.
Are you telling me he didn't win it? Was there some sort of, not subplot, but subliminal thing I didn't pick up on? He wins the leg lamp in some sort of contest.
What did I say? Bought it?
Yeah.
He didn't buy it. He won it. Yeah.
Well, I know. I thought maybe I missed something.
No.
I'm capable of missing.
Yeah, it was a major award.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, he was also Billy Madison's father.
Yeah. Okay.
But how did you end up watching that show, that movie, so often against your will?
Well, sometimes you do things for women just because they want you to.
You don't want to talk about this?
No. There's no reason to.
Well, yeah, but see, now everybody's making up their own story, and it's
well, let them. Let them. I don't care.
It probably is. And then, I mean, it sounds like you were held hostage.
I kind of felt that way. Every Christmas Eve, I kind of felt that way for about 6 years.
So we have Darren McGavin. We also have Robert Reed.
Of course. You know, I forgot about Mr. Brady.
Yeah.
Of course.
And also TV's McMillan.
Okay.
McMillan and wife? Was he not McMillan?
No, that was someone else.
Oh, George. Okay. I think I'm...
That was someone else, Steve. And I don't know why you would get those two confused, but that was someone else.
Okay. Terry Garr.
Oh, of course, and I forgot about her.
Frankenstein, Mr. Mom.
Sure.
Frequent Letterman guest.
Yeah, she's great.
From back in his radio days.
Oh, she went that far back
with him? Yeah.
Now, where did he do radio? In Indianapolis?
Indianapolis, yeah.
Interesting. I never knew that. I thought he was only on TV there.
Oh, no, he had a drive-time talk show for a while.
Interesting.
So,
wait a minute. Also, now, why would Terry Garr be hanging out in Indianapolis?
It doesn't make much sense, but she appeared on his radio program before she appeared on his network television program.
Hmm.
That's how they met, through the radio show.
Yeah, because there's always, like, I've seen the old clips from the TV show, you know, from the 80s, when she's on there, and there always seems like a weird sexual tension going on between the two.
Right.
Now that you explain that they go back that far, it kind of makes sense. Seems like they may have been lovers at some point.
You think something may have occurred?
Yeah.
Suzanne Pleshette.
No, I had no idea who that is.
She was Emily, what was his name in that show? The original Newhart show, Bob Newhart.
Never saw that.
She was Emily, I can't think of the name of Newhart, Hartley. She was Emily Hartley.
Okay.
Bob Newhart's wife in the Bob Newhart show. And she plays a TV journalist who's a love interest of Darren McGavin. And also Epstein from Welcome Back, Kotter.
Never saw that either.
Okay, well, he was in there. He was in the gang. We're not going to see them, but he was in a street gang that looked more like a bowling team.
Yeah. I remember the character. Yeah, but now the actor that you mentioned. Am I thinking of the guy that boxed Screech in a celebrity boxing match in the 90s?
No, I believe that was Ron Polillo who portrayed Horshack.
Horshack. Okay.
Welcome Back, Kotter.
All right.
Do you bet on celebrity boxing?
Well, it hasn't existed for over 20 years.
Well, I don't know. I assume it's going on in some high school gymnasium somewhere.
Yeah, it probably does. Or maybe we should organize it as part of the Rees company. We know a couple celebrities, right?
Well, so of the well-known faces of the era, that's pretty much it right there.
Well, no, I think you're missing a big one.
I don't think I am.
I think you're missing kind of the keystones of our program.
Well, I think you lied to our audience last week, but we'll get to that. We'll get to that. Shall we? You've selected the clips for tonight's program.
Well, so, I selected some of them. I didn't know they were the only clips we were going to show.
Well, see, part of the issue, and this will come up again when we review it, part of the issue is that this movie is so involved, and the plot is so thick, and it's actually, I don't want to spoil anything, but it's actually really well done.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
So to just sit here and review the plot and pick it apart, we really, there's no point in doing that. It would take us longer than the 2.5 hours it takes to just watch the movie and enjoy it at face value.
Yeah, as you said, it's like The Godfather. So we wouldn't sit here and summarize The Godfather. You should just go watch it. Like, there'd be no point in that. So we're kind of in the same boat here.
Yeah.
I think we both enjoyed it, right? We can just throw that out there now. We both enjoyed it. It's worth watching. So we really have some other things to point out. But I think the first thing, because I didn't know going in that I would enjoy it like this. I assumed it would be like all the other movies, which I, you know, whatever. And the very first scene did not dissuade me from the negative opinion I had going in. So if we could roll that.
Okay, let's see this.
No, this is there's the dad from.
I haven't seen you for 27 months, and now I have to go.
He's a detective.
We'll talk.
Second generation. We'll
talk.
And there's his son.
Right now, I just want you to know that it's good to have you home.
Thanks, Dad.
He's coming back from a career war, you know, I guess.
Your grandfather would have given the last 10 years of his life to be here to see you now. That's all he ever really wanted out of life, was a grandson. Well, it's good to have you home.
And through a war, right. Dad.
No.
I want you to hug me, embrace me, cry with me, and talk. Right, say what you feel. Let me say what I feel.
Who is he talking to?
All right, if we do that.
Not her.
Nothing will
fall
apart.
She snuck up on
it.
And by the way. I'll be quiet for a second.
Nothing.
Do you hear all that talking going on in the next room? They're one room over from a dinner party.
Yeah.
He's having this monologue with himself one room away from a crowded dinner party? That seems nuts.
Well, he's saying all the things he wants to say to his father.
Yeah. But that's not an internal monologue that you have with yourself? You're going to say that? You're going to walk into the next room and say that? So right away I'm thinking, all right, this is another one of these bullshit movies that Steve talked me into sitting through, even though I picked this one out.
I did.
But so I'm like, all right, another bullshit movie. It only goes up from there. If you can get through that, whatever that was.
It does stand out. That scene does stand out because there's no real reason for it. There are other ways to visually present his angst.
Exactly. Plot-wise, character-wise, there is a reason for it, but there's so many better ways to do that.
That was almost like Broadway.
Right, yeah. It's like an aside to the audience.
Yeah, or suddenly breaking in the song.
Right, yeah. But fortunately, and the whole, like, maybe first 30 minutes of it, they're switching. They like as the reason I said Korean Wars, because I got a little bit confused, because they're switching back from the 70s to the 50s.
Yeah.
And
all through which Darren McGavin looks exactly the same.
Yeah.
Sometimes it gets confusing as to, okay, where are we now?
Yeah. They gave him like one extra pat with blush to make him look younger. That's all they did. And until you figure out which scenes are supposed to be him in the current day, by which I mean the 70s, and the flashback in the 50s, it can be a little bit confusing. But man, if you stick with this, you really get drawn in, and it's really interesting.
It's worth it.
And we should just say, like, because we get, like, what is this movie even about? It's basically the life of a police chief as he deals with corruption within the New York Police Department.
Yeah, it's part Godfather, but also part Serpico.
Yeah, Serpico is another. Yeah, Serpico. Yeah. Yeah. So, I don't know what is the I don't know.
The next one is this is actually later in the film than the other clips we're going to show. This is the incident.
Oh, this is the person getting thrown out the window, much like Helen Hunt.
Yeah.
So the main character Darren McGavin. What was
Darren McGavin? Yeah.
Darren McGavin. His father was also I guess a chief, maybe some related rank in the New York Police Department. And we, up until this point in the film, we were led to believe that he died in the line of duty. In this scene, we learn the truth that maybe that definitely wasn't the case. And we'll see exactly how he met his demise.
Yeah.
He's not exercising a warrant.
Want some?
It's not for the comfort, Lola.
You made a trip for nothing, lover man.
Listen, don't ever shake your head at me, you trollop.
Oh, please, man.
What's that?
You think you know everything. First time you ever come here, Lola asked you to come. You didn't never even live till then. Ain't nobody ever showed you like Lola showed you. Now, when Lola want to show you again, Lola asked you to come, policeman. And now Lola going to teach you how to get out. Get out. Get out! Get out! Get out!
Ah, come on now, Lola.
All right, Steve, now we did just before this say about how this was a good movie. So that may not have been the best representation because that was, quite frankly, not all that well done.
It was, and I believe that's one of two scenes that actor appears in, and that's the only scene that actress appears in.
Right. Although I believe she did also appear as my upstairs neighbor from 1999 to 2001, who played Jay-Z nonstop, but I could be wrong about that. But yeah, so that, I mean, that's a little bit ridiculous, her falling out the window and him dying from a jab of a broken bottle.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I've had worse, but
it caught him in the wrong place, perhaps.
I guess, yeah.
By the way, tonight's show has a defenestration count of 2. what were the odds?
Yeah.
Okay, now you've chosen one more clip.
Yes.
It's kind of obligatory. We'll put it this way. We don't have a face turn for you tonight, so you know what we have.
We have Meredith Baxter Burney, of course, the namesake of all of this, the basis of a rating system, and of course she would make an appearance in this, as I promised last week. Mm-hmm.
I think you came up short with this promise, Chris.
Well... Do you have any evidence to back up your claim?
We'll get to the evidence soon enough, but okay. Let's show your little clip. And do you want to set this up?
No, I think we go into it cold.
Yes, yes. This is Chief O'Malley's sister.
Yes. And that's a rapist.
Yeah, he's been causing a stir, but...
He's a peeping Tom slash rapist. Chronic masturbator. He's a triple threat.
Quadruple threat because his cases get dismissed because his brother is a higher up in the police department. All right, so there you have it. A deadly justice.
Deadly justice of Meredith Baxter Burney.
I don't think
so. I mean, what could be more fitting for our program than that?
It's not Meredith Baxter.
Of course it is. Who else is that?
I don't know. She's uncredited, for all I could tell. But
she is uncredited.
It is not Meredith Baxter.
There are many roles in this film.
They wouldn't credit someone who wasn't in the film. You're right.
Well, but there are many
roles. I'm not credited in any other. There's a pretty good reason.
There are many roles in this film that are uncredited.
Yep, many
she is
are.
One of them.
And perhaps, I don't know what the name of that role is.
No, but I went through everyone who was credited.
Yeah.
And no one in the credits fit the person in that role. So Meredith Baxter Burney clearly was uncredited in this role. She clearly did it so that she could be with her mother, who plays the character of...
I don't know what character she plays. You're talking about Whitney Blake.
Blake. She plays the mother of the wife of the protagonist.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So clearly Meredith Baxter Chris wanted to do a show.
Here's my concern.
With her mother.
We've been doing this basically 10 years. And over the last decade, there are so many times we've promised things to the audience and we haven't followed through for many reasons, usually laziness and incompetence. Also, incapability altogether. I mean, sometimes the things we promise we can't deliver on because things fall apart for one reason or another.
Right.
I think with this show, the Rees Company, I kind of wanted us to get away from that. No longer making promises we can't keep. Telling the folks they're going to see something, and they end up not seeing it.
Well, don't worry about it, because we delivered exactly what we said last week. Meredith Baxter-Burney,
don't put me in this.
Getting
you
deadly justice.
Did not deliver on what you promised to the audience.
All right. See, now
you're making it out as though this was some landmark moment in TV movie history when...
it is.
Probably the most luminous figure in the history of the genre made her debut appearance in one of these.
Deadly justice in an alley, Steve. This isn't one of these, milquetoast date rape where her girlfriends have to get together later and tell her, no, it really was rape.
Deadly justice.
It wasn't like that. It wasn't a, my husband wants sex and I don't want to have it type of rape. This was dragged into an alley, straight on raped Meredith Baxter-Burney. This is the defining moment in the entire genre we're trying to do here.
How creepy is that ball bouncing away?
Exactly.
When you know what's going on. Just the innocence of a ball. You know, it's a happy, playful item just knocking about the pavement.
Yeah.
And only feet away, the most savage act humans have ever created is taking place.
I think murder is worse, but okay. You've taken a stand that I can't agree with.
Okay, well, I don't want to argue over the merits of deadly justice versus murder. How about if it's a deadly justice of a unicorn?
All right. Jim is standing there like some kind of psychopath
waiting
to speak.
I think he has information. He probably doesn't, but let's find out.
I have breaking news.
Yeah.
This is how Alex P. Keaton was created.
All right.
You stood there with your hand up like, I need to make a point.
Yeah.
For a good 90 seconds just to say that.
And
not, not only that, this is going to be the greatest contribution to a talk show ever.
No.
This is going to be Norm MacDonald and Courtney Thorne Smith.
Hold on to your hats, fellas. I got something for the show.
How old is the girl in this scene?
Well, that's indeterminate.
This is exactly what I think when we see the next scene, because the scene that precedes this.
So we have the next one, right?
You kind of cheated, Chris, because the scene you proposed we watched was a scene that may lead some audience members to believe that we're watching the deadly justice of Meredith Baxter.
Correctly lead them to believe it, yes.
Now, when you watch the entire scene, I'm sorry, the scene that precedes it, you will see that this is a completely different girl.
No, I disagree.
We can agree to disagree, but I think when you take a closer look, what were you watching on your phone? Is that the issue?
I was watching...
You're watching on your BlackBerry?
Yes.
Let's see the scene.
You're talking a big game, Steve. You're talking a big game,
deadly
man.
Deadly justice.
Here we see Meredith Baxter-Burney on the right.
Hey, Bri, listen. Are you in a good mood or a bad mood today?
Wait, you know what? You know what? That's
the
my bad.
Left looks
my bad, Jim. Let's stop it and back up to the beginning because we need to hear her speak because it's obviously her voice. It's obviously her voice.
Didn't Mom tell you to change your sneakers after school?
No one has this kind of accent.
Didn't Mom,
sis?
I just came back from a CYO basketball game. Hey, Bri, you in a good mood or a bad mood today?
It's not day. It's almost night, and that's a dumb question, kid.
Well, it's important for me to know, Bri, because if you're in a bad mood, I won't tell you about my shoe. If you're in a good mood, you give me a quarter, and I can go have it sewed back on.
Didn't Mom tell you to change your sneakers after school?
Yeah, but the basketball game...
Didn't Mom tell you to change your sneakers after school?
You're in a bad mood. Forget it. I'll just line it with cardboard and paste and glue and probably become a pathetic cripple.
Now, you get home before dark. You take the middle car where the conductor sits. What, you got it? And no shortcuts.
Okay.
There's the set ball.
Yeah, yeah. It's like the red jacket in Schindler's List.
You notice how we told her not to take the back alleys, which is what led to her deadly justice? But no, I mean, I could see how you would say, oh, she looks a little bit too young there. But listen to that voice, man. I wish I had I should have pulled a clip of Family Ties. Very few actresses by this point still spoke in that accent. That's an American standard accent that was popularized in the 1930s died out in the 1980s. She was one of the very last actresses to use that type of accent. It sounds just like her and looks like her.
Jim has taken the podium. Before I make a crushing blow to your argument, Jim has taken the podium. So here we go.
How old is the girl here?
What are you asking? The actor or the character?
How old do you guess this gal is? That's a fantastic question.
The character or the actor?
No, the actress.
The actress.
She's probably, what, 17?
No, I think she's a woman in her 20s playing a younger character, which is easy to do.
Meredith was born in 1947, so that makes this character 29 years old.
Right?
And
we've never seen a 29-year-old play a teenager before. Wow. Like, have you never seen 902? Has this guy never seen Beverly Hills 90210?
But she looks far younger. She only had to age 6 years to star in Family Ties. That show began 6 years after this. She does not look 6 years away from being Elise Keaton.
Dude.
She looks 15
years. All right. See, now you're going to make me say something I don't want to say because it's going to make me sound like a horrible person. But I'm going to say it. I'm going to say it anyway.
It's all right. You've already proven yourself to be a liar. What could be worse?
Are you not familiar with how women age between the ages of 29 and 35? They age, comparative to a man, they age a lifetime in those 6 years.
Are you not
And I'm not saying that about all women, but a lot of women do.
Screw Family Ties, Jim. Go to Meredith Baxter Family. Just Family. If you can. You'll probably get a lot of Family Ties, but I'll tell you, in 1976, it's the same time period, the show Family, she was a star of. And she was already Meredith Baxter in appearance, in the way she spoke.
All right, fair enough.
And I don't know if we can find anything pertinent, but she was indeed already.
Why wasn't this done before the show? I don't know. But now we're doing YouTube searches during the show?
Well, because I didn't know this is gonna be an issue. I provided you a photograph.
What other actress sounds like that of the time period?
We're not going by looks. We're going by, we're not going by voice. We're going by appearance.
Because your voice isn't distinctive? How is your voice not a distinctive part of?
It is very distinctive. But
how you're trying to identify
someone.
If you're
15 years older than the character you're playing and you're pulling it off, then you're.
That happens all the time. What are we
talking
about?
It happens all the time, but that was a little girl.
She was playing a little girl. The actress
was
not a little girl.
She was playing a little girl, which was almost typecasting.
By the way, we're seeing something now. It looks like one of the movies we've watched. Like, this could be Quarterback Princess for all I know.
There she is in the show Family, right there.
Yeah, wow. They took an actress and made her look older. And then they took an actress in the same year and made her look younger.
No, see,
where have we seen that before? I don't know. In the very movie,
we just
saw that with Darren McGavin just two minutes ago.
About how they made no attempt to make him age or de-age.
She doesn't look. They just took her hair and put it in a different way.
She has.
I can't see any difference
face.
Between the two. Right? Hold on, Jim's making a point. Hold the phone, people. All right.
Well, the last one was pretty good. How old do you think she is? That was a great question.
Yeah, we already said that.
No, she was not in that movie. When that movie was produced.
Allegedly.
By one asshole.
1976,
that's when Family debuted. And she was already a woman. Yes. So, Chris, you're going to have to concede defeat.
No, absolutely not. Until you get me some kind of full cast listing that tells me that there was an actress other than Meredith Baxter Burney that played that role. And good luck, Jim, because I searched for a long time.
You can't, because I looked too. Because I wanted Chris to be right simply because I'm tired of our audience being lied to.
Well, we're not. No one can prove us wrong, for one thing. And I completely, sincerely believe that I'm correct about this. That was her.
I don't know what to tell you, Chris.
We will get to the bottom of this.
Can we get her on the phone to ask her if she was in this movie?
We have gotten to the bottom of this.
No, can we get her on the phone? Or her agent? Or anyone involved in her impending estate?
Okay, in the intervening week, we'll give that a shot.
Yeah. We need to get to the bottom
and,
of this.
And she can set the record.
You know what? But then okay, all right.
That's something we might not be able to accomplish.
Now,
I don't
see,
want any more promises made that can't be kept.
Yeah, fair enough. I'm setting the bar kind of high. Could we get anyone associated with the production of Law & Order 1976 who could – we don't need to get them on a phone. All we need is to send them an email and ask.
Who was
right?
TV's McMillan? How am I so far off with that?
Rock Hudson, dude.
All right.
Oh, so who has a record of accuracy in this episode? Who would you trust, audience? Who knows what actor plays what roles?
Okay, well.
I'm all full of myself.
Shall we rate the motion picture Law & Order?
Yes. I hadn't actually given it a moment's thought until right now. But I'm going to throw out my highest rating yet.
How many Meredith Baxters do you award this film?
Three and a half.
See, I think it was cinema worthy.
Yeah, like you would go to a theater to see it.
Yeah, no, I mean, people know what words mean, Chris.
Wow. You know what you are is a sore loser. That's what I'm getting right now.
Steve, before you give yours, could I give mine?
Yeah, please.
I give it 29 stars for the age of Meredith Baxter in the movie and not the actress. It was obviously like 16.
I think you got that backwards, but okay, good try.
Well, I'm going to give it my second highest rating. I'm going to give this one 5 Meredith Baxters, and I'll tell you why.
I believe that ties your highest rating.
Yeah, that ties my highest rating. My highest rating prior to this was Who is Julia? And the reason why is not so much the motion picture itself, but how much I enjoyed talking about it. I think it provided a lot of fun banter.
Wow, that was fun. That argument we all just had, that was fun to you.
Oh, okay. No. Okay. No, I'm saying now I'm going to merit this one the same number of Meredith Baxters based on the quality of the film.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Now, Who Was Julia? I rated for that reason because it was a lot of fun to discuss.
Was it?
In my opinion, yeah.
Was that the one where you got mad at me at the end? Because you thought I was trying to leave early? That's what you thought was fun? Am I thinking of the wrong one?
You're probably thinking of the wrong one.
Okay. Who is Julia's where she gets transplanted into another body?
Yeah.
Yeah, I am thinking of the wrong one. Yeah. I'm thinking of the one we did the week after that, which was she was a doctor.
Jacqueline Smith was a doctor?
Yeah.
Who got deadly justiced.
Yeah, that one was.
At the hands of Bulldog from Frasier.
That one was god awful. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, I forgot what I gave that one. Maybe 3, something like that. 2. It's on the chart. You can see it.
Right. It's all up there.
All right. So is there anything else you'd like to say about the film?
Well, no, but we did have someone call in who heard we were talking about this film.
Yeah.
And thought he had something to contribute with a public service announcement.
Oh, wonderful. Well, we like doing those because it absolves us of the horrible things we've just spent the last half hour saying.
Right. And it's great when somebody else does them because then we don't have to do anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's an implicit endorsement of our own good deeds.
Sure. Why not? So let's roll that, I guess.
Okay, let's see this.
Yeah.
Hello, I'm Bob Kornfelter, alderman for the 9th Ward of Fairfax County. Although we in Fairfax County endeavor to keep our streets safe for all citizens, you may still encounter situations like this. As you saw, this man was minding his own business, attempting to masturbate in an alley, when he was rudely interrupted by someone bouncing a ball. Every citizen should be aware that bouncing a ball while running is a misdemeanor in Fairfax County. Bouncing a ball while running is not a harmless activity. If you were to lose control of the ball, and it were to bounce into the street, you could be struck by a car or a bus, or a tractor trailer, or even a hot dog cart. So please join me, Bob Kornfelter, Alderman for the 9th Ward of Fairfax County, in keeping our streets safe. And remember, keep the balls in the playground where they belong. Okay, well, thank you to Mr. Kornfelter for that. Steve?
Yeah, we appreciate the PSA, and thanks for making an excellent point. In that case, I think we did it, Chris.
I think we did it.
Okay, thank you so much for joining us. We don't have a movie yet for next week, do we?
No.
And, well, we will seek one. And
wait, are we not doing the one where Helen Hunt defenestrates herself?
I'm not sure the quality of the clip we watched. I'm not sure it's even watchable.
Yeah, we might need a better copy of that. Huh?
Yeah. So we'll track something down, and it's something we hope you'll enjoy. In that case, thank you so much, Jim, Chris Morgani, and not Meredith Baxter, because she did not appear on this program in any capacity. I'm Steve Rees.
Whatever, dude.
Holy Mackinac. We did it.